Well, good morning and welcome. So what do you think of the decorations?
Yes, indeed, they're very bright.
So. They are, they're merry and bright, and I have more to add to that. Here you go, honey. There you go, look at that. Here we go.
Even brighter.
Well, it's August 1st, the weather is hot, there's a chance of downpours, and so it's a great day to celebrate Christmas.
The truth is, Christmas in July, even though we're now in August, was started in 1933 as a tradition in a North Carolina camp by the director, who was a very creative woman by the name of Fanny Holt. We thought, even though it is August, since we are together, we will celebrate the beauty of Christmas together.
So let us breathe in that beauty as we calm our bodies and listen to the prelude.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was beautiful. Well, we know that it's really hard to wear masks. It's certainly hard for Rob and I not to see us smiling at you. But as you have read, there have been COVID cases with the new Delta variant that are coming through for even those that are vaccinated. Our own Manny, who has played piano for us, was rehearsing for Hamilton, and the people that were performing had their masks off, and Manny has COVID and is very sick. And so though he is not hospitalized, we have had several of our folks now that have contracted this new variant, even though they are vaccinated. So we are being extremely cautious with all of you. So we ask that you continue during the service to wear the mask over your nose and your mouth, and if it bothers you, you are welcome to just step outside for a moment, get a breath, and then come back in.
The hotel this morning has set up tables outside in the covered circle. And the good news is that we have lunch to go. Those lunches will be there. If you would like to eat on the tables there outside, feel free to do so. Or if you just want to take that meal with you home, you may do that as well. Regardless of the setbacks, we are blessed. And let us remember the blessings God offers as we pray. Child of light, let your spirit rest upon us and this place. Grant us the courage, O God, the wisdom and the strength to carry the message of Christmas with us all year long, acting as angels and shepherds, offering and receiving your gifts of grace and of mercy. In this we pray. Amen.
So we know that we all need a little Christmas, that this has been a challenging time, and it continues to have some challenges. And so if you want, you can leave your masks on and sing along with our choir as they lead us in We Need a Little Christmas. congregation says amen. Yeah, amen. Well, we had planned on surveying the community around worship, and we still will. But as things continue to evolve and change in this rapidly changing world that we are living in, we are changing the survey a little bit. So we are going to get that out to you, and we really ask, especially those that have come and worshiped with us, it's really important for us to hear your perspectives as we survey all of you. Also, if there are any needs within our community, if anybody does get sick, if anybody is having issues with food insecurity, or if you know anyone that is one of our elders that may be suffering, whether they're in our community or in your neighborhood, please let us know. Contact the office, speak to Rob and myself.
Well, COVID is teaching us patience, or at least it is trying to do so. And as a little help and aid in learning patience, not only are we offering you a meal to go today, but also there are little bags of bread dough, and we are going to have communion next week. We will be online, and please take bread dough with you. If you want to take one, if you want to take one for a neighbor, feel free to do that. And of course, the dough needs time to rise. It must be kneaded. We must nurture it. And as we do, we discover that we are indeed blessed. It helps us to learn and understand the fruits of patience.
And then next week, of course, as we celebrate communion, we will be back online. And so let us now listen as our choir continues to offer their gifts to us.
Thank you.
Our first scripture reading for this morning comes from the Gospel of John. It's chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Let us open our hearts and our minds, our spirits, to the Word and to the inspiration of God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things came into being through him. And without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him is life. And the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Our second scripture reading for this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke. Again, a very familiar Christmas passage. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And then an angel of the Lord stood before the shepherds, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Messiah, the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those God favors." Here ends our readings. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, may the words of my mouth, meditations of our hearts and our minds, even our spirits, may these be acceptable in your sight. O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, the joy, the sheer joy of Christmas, it so often comes disguised, a little hard to recognize, and to demonstrate that to you, I'm going to need your help. So please, if you can, play along. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Avery.
Avery.
A very Merry Christmas. Hold on. Joy is, it's gonna come, I swear. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Anna. And a partridge in a pear tree. Only one more. Knock, knock.
There.
Yeah.
Yahoo.
I see you're excited for Christmas in August like I am. Good for you all. As you can see, or perhaps you can guess, that the joy of a knock, knock joke comes disguised, just as the joy of Christmas does. And when Christmas comes disguised, so often it comes disguised as an annoyance, as an untimely burden, as a hope so naive that it feels a little embarrassing to mention it out loud, and even hard to explain. After all, that is how Christmas came to Mary. Being engaged to Joseph at the time, Gabriel angel's announcement, the birth announcement, it was untimely, and it was certainly hard to explain. Traveling to Bethlehem on a donkey, 8 months pregnant, again, is an untimely burden. As was having to give birth, of course, outside among the animals, and yet, somehow, through all of that, still, Mary finds it all to be good news of great joy. which is why celebrating Christmas in August or July seems perfect, for it recalls Christmas's original untimeliness. One of my favorite quotes comes from Maya Angelou, who says this: "You can learn a lot about a person by the way they handle three things in life: a rainy day, lost luggage, and a tangled string of Christmas tree lights. For that is when you discover whether they have within them what it takes, the light and the hope to find and create joy despite life's disappointments and hardships." Well, let me tell you a story about a woman named Amy Wolf, who must be an expert Christmas tree light untangler. For in her hometown of Newburgh, Oregon, they had, it seemed, a plague one summer of suicides, including several in the schools. A dark cloud seemed to be hovering over the entire community, and it hurt her heart. She wanted to do something about it, something tangible. But like Mary and Joseph, like us, she didn't think that she had the time or the resources or the qualifications to do something big enough to create change in her community. But she did think of one thing, one small thing. She could share the hope and the light that was within her, and she could print yard signs with encouraging phrases like, "Don't give up," like, "You're enough," "Your mistakes do not define you." But she went out and priced the sign. She found that they were more expensive than she thought, about $15 a sign. She didn't think she could afford it. And so she went to a friend who said that she could make them at cost for $7. She was in the design business. But even that would be a burden to the family budget. So she and her husband got together, and they decided that they could afford to invest $140 in 20 signs. And then she put the signs in her car. And as she was driving through town, trying to find high visibility homes, and that she could ask them to put up one of these signs in their front yard for 2 weeks, she suddenly had a panic attack. "Who do you think you are?" she asked herself. "People are really hurting. They're grieving. And this seems so lame, so insignificant, so inadequate." When she pulled up into the driveway of the first house, she couldn't even get out of the car. She was too embarrassed to have to go to the front door and explain to a perfect stranger why she thought it was a good idea, why it would make a difference to put one of these signs in the front yard. And sometimes love is like that. It's a little hard to explain. It seems foolish, just a little too naive. She wanted to turn around and go home. I wonder if Mary and Joseph ever felt the same way. I know that sometimes I do. I wonder if you do too. But, of course, her family was in the car with her. They reminded her that they've already spent the $140. And after all, one of the signs in the back says, "Don't give up." And so she did not. With apprehension and with her 7-year-old in tow for security reasons, she went to the front door. And the person was indeed a little gruff. She wasn't sure that he really understood what she was asking, but he did it anyway. He put the sign up in the front yard. And after all 20 were up, she waited with apprehension to see what would be the response in the town, or worse, that there would be no response. And to her surprise, after a week, there was such positive reaction to the signs that 120 people within 5 days had contacted her wanting a sign in their yard. Then about a month later, she anxiously opened up a letter that she received that was addressed to Do-Gooder. She opened it up and the letter said, "I had been depressed so long I couldn't take it anymore. One afternoon I decided that I too would kill myself. But before I did that, I wanted to take one last nostalgic drive to my childhood neighborhood. And then I saw one of your signs. And it said, 'Don't give up.' It got my attention, but still, I drove by on my way home. And then a mile down the road, I saw another sign, and this one said, 'You matter.' When I got home, I sat down and I shared what I had been going through with my family, about my depression, and I've started treatment. I'm alive because of your signs. I just wanted you to know that and to thank you. It was signed, 'You saved me.' Joy does come, and the way joy and life come is from an infusion of love and hope into another's darkness. That is, of course, the very definition of Christmas itself. God so loved the world that God sent Jesus. Sent Jesus, infusing into the world a tangible sign of love. And that is exactly what Amy's sign did in her town. By the way, in the middle of summer, when it wasn't even supposed to be Christmas. Well, as we celebrate the hope of Christmas today, what would Christmas be without gifts? And so, under your chairs, you have a Christmas gift. I have one here. Now, usually Christmas gifts under a Christmas tree, but they're under your seat. Perhaps if you're in the choir, it's next to you. So reach under there and go ahead and open up the present. I'm so excited. But you know it's not a pony. It wouldn't fit in the envelope. Your present contains two things. One, this is the cover of the book that Amy wrote about her experience. It's called Signs of Hope. It is truly amazing, truly inspirational. You can get it online. It's an ebook. Get it at the bookstore. And along with that, on the back are testimonials of how her simple acts of sharing those signs with neighbors have made in people's lives. Also, there are little signs, little cards, and these have the same messages that Amy put in her yard signs. You should have some that are in English. You should have some that are in Spanish. These cards are for you, for whatever it is that you face in your life, but they are also for you to share, to give out to others. Although small, they really do have the ability, as we just heard, with God's help, to spread Christmas light and hope into another's darkness. But to do so, just as Christmas joy itself needs, it needs us to pass it on. So I encourage you, please, to overcome whatever feelings you may have in sharing those cards. Amy struggled with the same. Mary struggled with the same. Because Christmas is not only a gift, it is also a responsibility. For Christmas joy to be received, it must also be given. That is how the light and the hope and the peace of Christmas grow. That's how it grows for you. It's how it grows in this world, in December or August or any time. May it grow within us. Merry Christmas and Amen.
Thank you so much. Plus, I really like your hats. You look so cute. So we have a tradition in our community. If you have a prayer concern or a celebration that you would like to lift up, please send those and forward those to the office or to Rob and myself, and we will include it in the weekly prayer. Or if you'd like a private prayer, you just need to tell us. This prayer is written and based on the poetry of Howard Thurman. If you haven't read Howard Thurman, he's amazing. When the song of the angels is stilled, when the star in the sky is gone, when the kings and princes are home, when the shepherds are back with their flocks, it is then that the work of Christmas begins. To find the lost, to heal those broken in spirit, to feed the hungry, to release the oppressed, to rebuild nations and bring peace and equality to all people. When we see that all God's children are treated as precious and the last is first, we will know that Christmas has come. This morning we pray. We pray for all seeking the child, for those suffering across our country and globe, for those struggling with illness, for Brenda, who is in hospice, for Patty and Joan Mary, Dr. Marshall, Gloria Violet, for Jack and Lynn and Kurt and Manny. We pray. And for Gina, may God's perpetual light shine upon her and give her eternal peace. And in a time of silence, we lift up our own concerns, knowing that you hear us, God, and you will guide us. Prince of Peace, today we pray to be Christmas people, to bring hope and joy and love, to spread goodwill and peace to all. In this we pray. And as Jesus taught us to say, we say together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
you. That was so beautiful. Well, we as a church challenged our community following the events of Surfside to make prayer shawls, and here are just a few. Well, prayer shawls are made, and we pray as we knit. And as we do, when we hand them to another, the idea is that they are surrounded by those prayers. And of course, in the case of first responders, they risk so much on our behalf. So today, we want to thank them by offering these shawls and continue. If you don't know how to knit, it's all okay. We can give you all the supplies. And Valerie Pearson, one of our members, has put on our website instructions as to how to knit your first prayer shawl. And so you can learn and join us in this amazing endeavor.
Well, speaking of first responders, as you know, Davidson Belazaire has been with us now for several years. He has aided us as we have moved facilities every Sunday as well to get everything that we need from storage to here. And during COVID, ensured that many had food and the necessities that they required. But he has always had a dream from childhood to become a police officer. And in 2 weeks, he leaves us for Police Academy in Colorado and will be serving in Aurora, Colorado on the police force.
So we want to invite Davidson to come forward and with all of you acknowledge all he has done. In these extraordinary times, he has delivered meals and helped our congregants and done amazing things. So, Davidson, this shawl is blue. And we don't ever want you to forget that even though you are not with us physically, you will be with us and we will be with you no matter where you go.
Thank you.
Always.
Let us say a quick prayer. Gracious God, surround Davidson with your light, with your protection, that he may share his light and protect others. Our hearts are sad to see him leave, but we take solace in knowing all of those that he will encounter in his new workplace, all of those that need his calm, his peace, his joyful smile as they go through difficult and trying times. For this brief time we have had with him in our midst, to see his light, we give you thanks. May it burn always bright as we know it will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Bless you, Davidson. Well, we are God's beacons of light on earth. You may feel discouraged at times, maybe even now. Hope may at times seem a little hard to hold on to, but as people of faith, we believe that God shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it and will not. But we must be willing to be beacons of light, of hope, and love. And so at this time, we are lighting candles. We will light some on the aisles. We ask you to share it, just as Amy shared the light and hope within her. Share your light with your neighbors as the choir leads us in song. Thank you.
We'll look around and see God's light and the beauty.
Look around and see love's pure light.
Look around and breathe in peace.
And hope, joy, and love.
Breathe in a little Christmas, even in August.
And go forth acting like Christmas people.
Sharing this light that's in all of you with all of those whom you encounter along the way. Amen. And so we invite you to keep shining that light as we listen to our postlude.